Hello, Reinoud.
Hello, Peter. How are you?
How are you?
I'm very fine. Thank you.
I'm also fine. Thank you. Thanks for taking the time for this conversation. I'm looking forward to it. Now, you're a very special guest, especially in these special times, because you are actually doing something great for humanity. You're actually working in UZ Leuven. Okay, it's the IT department, but now these corona times, I know what the impact is on the hospital, on UZ Leuven, but what is the impact on your division, on the things you're doing?
Also a lot, of course, because we are the supporting team of the hospital. It's of course very demanding times, and the whole hospital is changing in a very short period. As IT, you have to follow, and it's on different ways. One way is, of course, we just change wards completely from a normal ward to a corona ward, where then the new patients, the corona patients, can come. And this, of course, has to change also the whole IT infrastructure of those places. Okay. Also, of course, the electronic patient record system that we use, also you have to adapt, because you move completely wards from one building to the other, and all this kind of things has to change. Mm-hmm. But also functionality, you want that the nurse, the physician, immediately see that this patient is tested for corona or suspected for corona, and all this kind of information. So also there are a lot of changes.
Okay.
We have to report to the government, so also there is a team working on this.
Okay.
Do this automatically, because otherwise by hand you make errors, it's not up to date. The government wants at least twice a day numbers of each hospital, so we try to provide this. But the most important, I think, for us, what has the most impact, was helping the patients directly. Because all the rest, what I mentioned there, was business as usual. Of course, it's a little bit stressy, but this kind of things, that's where we are for, and that's the normal things. Only comes a lot of work in a short period. But it's because visitors are not allowed anymore in the hospital. So there was a big demand how we can have that the patient has contact with their family, even in a very difficult and worse situation sometimes. Mm-hmm. We were very happy that some of my guys jump on it and created, with all the tools that were available in a very short notice, a system that, like we now talking to each other, that also patients could talk with their family on a regular basis, or even, and that's really sad, of course, but also it happens in the last moments that they have to talk with the family on the other side.
That's an interesting one. I had the perception, because there are a lot of patients, that the hospital is really focusing on managing, processing patients and make sure they get out as soon as possible. But you are actually adding on top of a kind of experience layer, because this is a very important one, because especially elderly people or people who are very sick and who maybe are not going to make it, they cannot see their family anymore. Who is that? Something that came from your department? People said, okay,
no,
we're going to...
it's general, but I think the problem is, of course, in the media, everybody is focused on the physicians that in the war zone completely covered, the nurses that are really working hard and in difficult circumstances, the pictures of the masks with all this is the things that comes in the media, in the press, and this is of course true, and it's really hardworking and confronting. But there's also a lot of people in the background working, and so a social department, for example, plays an important role here. They are there always in normal circumstances, but definitely in this kind of difficult periods, they really have the focus of to see the social aspect of the patient, and definitely when you can't visit and have very difficulties to contact with your family and friends. And so they are also there in the war zone and also see this, and they try to manage with the tools they have. And it's a social department, for example, together with some of the physicians that contact us to see, we see this problem, how can we solve it? And then in, in just in a weekend time, we provide a full solution for helping them, for helping the patients to have contact with the families.
In February, I was in Egypt, and there I saw some Chinese people wearing masks, and I still remember telling to my wife, we were a little bit laughing with that. We were like, why are they wearing masks? And at that time already, Corona was already known or just started a little bit in China. And of course, like a lot of people, I did not expect that exponential impact. When were you involved? Was it like a couple of weeks before the lockdown, or was it already in mid-February that the hospitals already were, I wouldn't say informed about this pandemic that was coming, or how did that work, that process?
Yeah, I think the timing is more or less correct, but I was on holidays just before the lockdown.
Okay.
I left, the end of February. And at that time, I was still, like you say, like most of the people thinking, okay, there is some virus there in China. Mm-hmm. Okay, it's serious, but we will have it under control. At that time, when I left on holidays in the hospital, was already talking about it, but I had not a feeling that it was really already also taken very serious, because otherwise also my mind would be probably different. Mm-hmm. We saw it as a threat, possibility. There were already groups thinking of how we, if we have some extra patients, how we will do it. And then 2 weeks of holidays, well, 2 weeks, when, yeah, almost 2 weeks, I came back, I think the 9th of March. So I left end of February, and then the 9th of March I was back. And the first day on the office, the 10th, yeah, I saw the world is completely changed. Also in the hospital, the crisis infrastructure was there, the management that managed the crisis, all the things were already in place, they were talking about it. And yeah, my first reaction, I came from holidays, was a little bit exaggerating. But after the second day, I said, no, those guys mean it very seriously. And then the third day, we were already making place in the hospital for the first patients that still were not there at that moment or are coming. So, because I was 2 weeks away, I missed a part. On holidays, I really not connected with work. It's holidays. But I saw a big difference today, just the day before I was leaving to holidays, and when I came back, the hospital was in a different mode. It was from a just business as usual with some attention too. And when I came back, it was a war zone, everything was focused on one thing, and that was COVID.
Hey, you're talking about war zone. Does that mean that you now have the feeling, and you and your team, that you, together with all your colleagues, well, because I fully agree, I mean, the doctors and the nurses, they're doing amazing jobs. Mm-hmm. They're heroes, but you are guys also are heroes. So it's everybody together. You have the feeling that everybody is now working towards that common purpose more than ever before, and working as one team, where maybe in the past, you had the different silos in the organization, whereas now everybody is really focused on,
Of course, this is, I think in general, we work more or less well together in the hospital, in every company. Yeah. But if this kind of things happens, then it's everybody focused on one thing, go together, join effort, you do more than you would do in general. In general, you would say, we have to see, follow procedure here, approval there. Of course, we still do this, but you don't escape anymore, or you hide. You don't hide you anymore about rules and things. You go for it, and you see everybody tries to do the best. It's a team effort for the whole hospital. Yeah. Some pieces are more important than others, some people are more confronted with the situation than us. IT in general, we are more in the back, of course, and that's more luxury situation. Mm-hmm. there. But yeah, every piece is together. But what's important that you feel now it's all together to go for it and to combat the virus.
I mean, I see that people in this situation react in two possible ways. Or they accept it and they go with it and they take time to reflect or do what necessary, take action. And the other ones are more feeling fearful. I mean, some people, especially by social media and the media, they think like, hey, and it's serious. Yeah? I'm not going to say it's not serious, but I also believe that just focusing on fear will actually give you more fear. Were there people in your team or colleagues that you had to manage? Because I see that in our organization that some people, because they're really socially isolated, I wouldn't say they're having a depression, but they're suffering.
Yeah. Peter, like always, in every situation, you have different kind of people that react on this differently. And what you say is completely true. Also, in my environment, in the friends, but also in my team, everybody reacts differently. Everybody's personal situation is also differently. I'm a very luxury situation. I'm just here with my wife, just sitting here in a big house, relatively big house with a garden in the middle of the city, no kids around. Yeah, that's easy. If you imagine you are alone and the only person that you see is by Skype or Zoom, it's a complete different situation. Mm-hmm. Or you have four kids around you, that's also a complete different situation. And then indeed the fear, you feel some people are really focused on it, follow the news every second. That only makes them getting the fear, and you get in a negative spiral, negative whatever,
circle.
Negative circle. But they can't help, of course, because it's how they are. Everybody reacts differently. It's also the difference between an introvert and an extrovert. The introverts now, some of them, they are very happy now because they don't have to sit in an office with 60 other people. They can do their thing very focused on their desk. And they are now, they say, I'm much more productive than before. And other people, everybody reacts differently. But you have to pay attention to this. Yeah. So that's from the first moment, because telework continuously, nobody has done this before, or not much people before on this scale. So every day, each team has to, in the morning or in the day, a stand-up to see, hey, and not only about business, about things, but also how it's with kids and this kind of things. And also important is from time to time that the team lead individual has a call like this here, just to one-on-one to see and to talk about the small things, the big things, to see that everybody is okay. And you see then with those conversations, you see everybody is reacting differently. Also on the floor. So I have still people in the hospital because, printers, computers, they still get broken even in COVID time. So you have to replace them, this kind of thing. So you see also different reaction person to say, okay, I will take my mask, I will wash my hands, I'm comfy that everything will go right, and we go for it, and we go in the hospital and do this. Even on the COVID units, they go. And other people say, I really fear to go inside, while in general it's relatively safe. But it's how you look at the things, and it's very difficult to change this, because I think this is really something, it's inside the people, and of course you can talk with them, that helps, of course, we never force people, of course, also not, but it helps. But it's how people react, and that's always different. And that makes it, of course, interesting, but also challenging in some cases.
And do you think, what do you think the world would look like post-corona, generally spoken? Do you think?
I don't know. I thought about a lot of it. We talk also here a lot of it. I think Personally, I think in 3-4 years, the same as before.
Okay.
It's not that I want it that's the same as before, but I think we are, it's our habits. It's we like what we do and how mm-hmm. we do it. And I think it will, at the end, back to business. In the beginning, not that traveling will be different, will be different. Also, the airline industry, prices of the tickets will go up the next year. So not every week a city trip anymore, this kind of things. But I think at the end, unfortunately, I think we will come back where we were. I think it's very difficult to change that. That's my personal feeling.
And do you think on UZ Leuven, for instance, within IT, that maybe teleworking is going to be more the standard?
This kind of things, but I don't see this as a huge thing. What you see is we have proven, all of us, not usually all of us, that telework can work. A lot of companies that were a little bit afraid of telework. So now they can see, well, it works. I don't think so. I think telework will in more companies much more. You will see more. But that we now all will work 50% from home at the end, I don't think so. So I think it's not will not be a big change. You will see some kind of things that we now do. Yeah, that of course for the benefits we will also do after Corona, but not that it's, I don't really think it will be a enormous big change. I hope, for example, a complete other area is we see now that because we have outsourced all our productions of masks and medical equipment, even medications to, for example, in those cases, most of the time to China. Now we say we have to do it back here, more local, so that when a disaster happens, we have our own resources. You will probably see this as the first moment after when the crisis is over. You will see some initiatives clearly to do this. But I think after a year or five, economy will come back and they say, produce it, maybe not in China, but wherever, other place in the globe. Well, let's go there. It's cheaper. It's more efficient. Well, and let's do it there. And then I think in 5-6 years, we will make the same mistakes as before.
Well, I share the same opinion. I think the majority of people, they are very reluctant to change and they don't see the lesson or don't take the time for a lesson. And that's fine. Eh? But I think, a small amount of people, and it really depends on your situation. I think people who are already not happy with their lives on whatever situation, for instance on work, this is now the time to reflect, because they have lots of time, and in the beginning they will I think they will go crazy, but at a certain time they will go through that craziness. And if you then add some things like, oh, you have children, but it's really challenging to and take care of your children and to do your work and maybe to teach them and things like that. And then your employer says, you have to take it for yourself. I mean, you just take holidays to take care of your children. It's your problem. I know such situations. Also situations where they are obliged to work in the office because the IT system cannot be contacted remotely, because it's still a very, I don't know, legacy system. Which is also kind of BS, but that's another discussion. And also people who are, I wouldn't say struggling with themselves, maybe are going to look for more purpose-driven, I wouldn't say job, but and because I had some people here who are younger than us, like 23 or 28, I don't want to generalize, but I had the feeling that they are more focused on the purpose thing, what they want to do with their lives, than I was at that age, to be honest. And I think I see a little shift. Does that mean that I see a shift for everybody? No, not at all.
I agree. I think this kind of crisis is, and doesn't it can be Corona, but it can also another personal crisis that you have, creates also for individuals some opportunities and changes. Mm. But I don't think that in general, if you put all the people back together, that there is a change on the big level. But individual, this can be definitely change people's life because, yeah, indeed, like you say, you will reflect things. There, you are in shit, but shit can also create opportunities. Yeah. But that's on the individual level. And there, yeah, I think it can change people, persons, how they think and how they go forward with their lives. But in general, if you then look in general to the people, to the Belgian society, the European society, the world society, I don't think at the end it will not change change much.
I'm going to now shift to a complete other subject, and I it's a sensitive subject, so because this is recording, so be sensitive with what you're going to talk about. Some people see this crisis also as an opportunity, especially hackers. So I wouldn't say the bad ones. Do you see now more attacks in general towards UZLEU?
No, not really. Not more than before.
Okay.
It's difficult to say because it's only just a month and you have to see it a little bit longer period. Yeah. But these kind of things attract bad things also. Also, well, you can also see it as a business. They have a business, there's a new situation, and the smart guys, they take the opportunity there. So what I see more as a risk now for a lot of companies, and definitely for hospitals now, is that we are under stress. We are in a war zone. And that means that you are focused on one thing.
Yeah, I understand.
That means that you probably neglect some other things. Mm-hmm. We have suddenly UZ Leuven didn't had just a very low amount of people in UZ Leuven could do telework. Now we are at 1,500. They've never done it before. We had to create this. We had to onboard them for doing telework. Yeah, this is a risk. It's a change that normally this kind of projects you take months for preparing, educating, and this. Yeah, no, this is just suddenly because of the you have to exchange data with the government and this kind of things. Normally, you start slowly on a whiteboard thinking how we would do it, how we do it secure, GDPR wise, and this kind of things. Now we have to do it in 24 or 48 hours. That doesn't mean it's unsafe or we don't take care of GDPR. Mm. That's something else. Mm. But normally you take much more time for it. And so it's a possibility that you, forget something. Mm. So that's also why I really asked to the security team, we had to put more focus on it instead of less, because it's really important. There's so much change in the hospital, in the way we work, that of course, you are more vulnerable.
That's true.
See it as a war on the front gate of your castle. The army is coming. But maybe in the back is a small army between the woods. But you are now paying attention because all the focus is on the front door, because there is the what you think the real enemy. And so I think a lot of companies now, and especially hospitals, but probably also others, because of the changing now, the changing of working, you're more vulnerable because change creates always vulnerabilities. And so, and that's, I think, what hackers see today. They see this change and they see this opportunity. We try to do our best and put a lot of effort in it to keep the hospital running. But it's also a really unfair battle.
It is. Now, war does also mean that you're going in some kind of protection modus and not a growth modus. I mean, are there already lessons that you are learning through this corona that you will think, after corona, we're going to do this or this or this in IT that will change your strategy? Things that you learned, like, this is interesting. Maybe the whiteboard thing is a great thing, but maybe we have seen that our teams are working great, but maybe we can, I don't know, a tool or a process or whatever that you say, I'm going, this is something due to Corona that shifted my
thinking. At this moment, it's for me too early. I think we have to make this exercise afterwards. It's not that I now already look, oh, if we have done this before, then what I see, of course, now is, so we will do this exercise definitely after the crisis to see how we did it. It's also always important to reflect a little bit to see how we did it, where we could do better, why we couldn't do better. And then maybe you say, oh, maybe if we had this in place already, then it could be going faster and this kind of things. And yeah, we have to see this. This is too early. What I see now, and that's the opposite, is, of course, we talk about it already. This Corona creates also opportunities. And one of the opportunities is, for example, tele and video consult. Okay. Everybody was already talking for ages for this, but was never a legal agreement there, and also not a financial agreement with the government. So everything was in place in our hospital. We had software, it was integrated in the medical file, but nobody was using. Why was nobody using it? Because there was no legal framework, there was no financial framework. And so, yeah, now suddenly, yeah, this is the only solution. They have to have contact with their patients because patients can't come to the hospital or have fear to go to the hospital. So telework and teleconsult, well, not telework, teleconsult, I mean, and video consult. Yeah. Now, yeah, there is agreement there, how they can use it, in what cases, and also what it financial means for the patient and for the physician or for the hospital. And then, so I know, yeah, you know, you start seeing using this. And that's that's an opportunity because we will definitely, I think that, definitely after the crisis we'll use this for some kind of patients because you have patients that for the you have a disease a pathology and you have every 6 months you have to come back to the physician, and in some cases there's conversations just hi Peter, how are you? Fine, everything okay, have you got some high pressure, this or a little bit dizziness? No, everything is fine. Okay, see you next 6 months. This kind of conversations you can definitely perfectly do remote. It's much more efficient for the hospital, the physician, and for the patient, of course. And I think this kind of opportunities, they are there, and that you will see, of course, afterwards, that you say, we will do this more, or also after Corona.
Interesting. Now, you have been, you started your career in is it Leuven more than 20 years ago? 25 years ago?
And 25 years ago, 25 yes.
25 years ago.
Yeah, I'm part of the furniture.
You're 40 years plus. And and then now you're managing, leading, because I don't like the word managing people. You manage things. What do you see in IT? And I know it's going to be technology, and that's a very general thing, between 25 years ago and now.
Oh, a lot of things changed. Although also a lot of things came back with another form. Technology-wise, yeah, I think everybody knows what changed. I think this is less interesting. If I look to the relation IT with the hospital, the relation there, and also there is of course a lot of changes, and I find this much more interesting than just that you use another technology because the technology is there. That are just tools to get where you want to be. So in the beginning was just it was the hospital, and the hospital was taking care of a patient. And so the software we provide was just doing this. Was a central database and was optimized for taking care of the patient, but focused on the hospital. on the workflow of the hospital, on the workflow, to optimize the workflow, to share data between caretakers in the hospital.
Yeah.
Everybody who was involved around taking care of the patient used the software, but was only internally. It was mm-hmm. focused. The patient is there. He is sick. We have to get him better as soon as possible.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was a very hospital-centric approach. And then, begin 2000, we say, well, the hospital is not only part of this story. It's also important to connect with the home physician or an external specialist that sends the patient to the hospital. Because in the past, how it worked, you come to a home physician, a little bit pain here, then the home physician say, I will send you to the hospital. He writes a nice letter of two lines and sent you to the hospital. And then the home physician had to wait till he received a letter by mail from the hospital, where then it say, with Peter, everything okay. And that could take a long time. And so begin 2003, we start say, well, let's involve also the home physician or the external specialist that sent the patient. And so we give them access to the patient file at that time. So it was begin 2000, I think 2003, whatever, doesn't mean. But you saw already a shift. It was not only the hospital, but also the hospital and the home physician. Then a little bit later in 2006 or 2007, say, well, the hospital is small because we work together with other hospitals, and a patient, especially when it's a complex pathology, mm-hmm. goes from one hospital to another. For example, do the first exams in one hospital, and then because it's complex, they send the patient to the university hospital, for mm-hmm. example, like us. And you have to treat the patients together. What if we can exchange the patient data between those hospitals? It's a complex thing because everybody has his own system. They are not compatible. Of course, you can exchange a name and an address and a birth date, but that's it. All the rest is much more complex. So we start saying, well, let's work together with a lot of hospitals, some of the hospitals, and share the electronic patient file so that we also, as hospitals, sharing information and sharing the patient data. So not only hospital focus, not only with the home physicians that send the patient, but also with your neighbors, your friends, because we work together, we send patients to each other, and then the treatment can be uniform over this. Then of course, at some moment you say, well, the most important part we forget, and that's the patient. And that's what's happening is on this moment. The patient is also a very important part of the treatment. And so today it's really important that also the patient has view on the patient data, on his data. Not only a view, but also can interact with the team that work around him. And not only just viewing, but really interacting, and that's where then the mobile apps comes,
where a patient
can see his information, but also can interact with the team, with the physician, with the nurse, whatever, depending on the situation. Where also things at home, you can enter your blood pressure automatically or by hand, whatever. You can, for example. Even sugar values for diabetes, this kind of things. In the past, you write it down in a book. Now you can do it electronically, and you can do much more things with it. And you can and you really involve the patient in the treatment. GDPR has helped us there, but we were already starting with this before that, long before that. But GDPR helps us to convince everybody that this is important, that the patient is a part of the treatment, and that's what they call, but I hate the term, patient-centric approach. Mm-hmm. It was always patient-centric. That's the, even in the Middle Ages, was patient-centric because that was what you do. You helped the patient. But now in the information, he's in the loop and he's also really a part of the treatment team. Of that's mm-hmm. at the end he has to be. So, for example, what you saw is we opened. So the patient files to the patient, so they can see their own patient files, and you see already the benefits there. Of course, you get some discussions because there are some informations that you maybe don't agree, but sometimes there are also wrong information. You go to a consult, you talk a half hour, 20 minutes, 10 minutes, 5 minutes with a physician. Yeah, he writes it down. It's possible that you were, as a patient, nervous and you didn't say it wrong. But it's also possible that the physician didn't understood you well and noted wrong. So that's really interesting. That, of course, doesn't happen often, but you see some interactions. It was not my uncle that has the same illness, but it was a friend. You mistake or reverse for when it's... my blood pressure was okay, but my temperature was high. I just give stupid examples, but sometimes this happens because you are nervous as a patient because you have only the 5 minutes of window of opportunity to tell your story, that you make mistakes. But of course, physicians or nurses or other people involved can also make a mistake. And this is very interesting. And then the interactive way of communication, reporting every time, for example, how much pain you have, if you have a pain treatment. If you put it electronically in the app, directly in your patient file, then also the hospital can follow up. You can have some rules in the background running on this and can create alerts and this kind of things. So the patient becomes much more important in the whole treatment. And that's where we are today. And then you will probably ask, but I will do it in your name. And how you see it then in the next 5 years going.
In the deets.
I think there is... I think... It's difficult to say, but on this moment, healthcare is very reactive. Mm-hmm. You are ill, and then you go to the doctor. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's the same as my car is broken, then I go to the garage. Mm-hmm. It would be much better if we could have a model that we could avoid that you get ill.
Yeah.
That we can do the things up front, just before it gets worse. But that needs a complete change. Of course, it doesn't work for everybody and mm-hmm. for all cases, but for some it works. But it has to change in this so that we can avoid this. And you see in the States are much more, are already some initiatives there because their healthcare is managed by insurance companies.
Okay.
So, yeah, more or less. I just make it short, but it's more or less. That means their interest is you don't go to the hospital.
Yeah, because they have to pay you.
If you go to hospital, I have to pay. So they try to avoid that you go to the hospital. So there you have already kind of apps that you have to install. You come to me as an insurance company, perfect. This is your rate. But if you install that app, your rate is lower. Mm-hmm. And why is it lower? Because then you have to say how you are, what you eat, or maybe you have to sport once a week.
Yeah, smoking,
drinking, here in Europe it's much more complicated to do this, but there are some initiatives and it's nice to see and to look and to see what the outcome there is. But because it's the insurance company that manage and really wants that you don't go to the hospital, you see there in the States already some initiatives here. Also, for example, you have a pathology and then they say every 6 months you have to come back for a checkup. Mm-hmm. But that's why 6 months? Well, that's an average. An average, that means it's never be the right period for you, but it's an average. And what if you could do just like your car suddenly says today, hello, it's time for going to the garage, because I think it's time for going to the garage based on a lot of parameters. And not just because it's fixed 30 or 40,000 kilometers you have drawn. If we could monitor some of the parameters there, individual to you, then maybe it's time. Then we could send a message from, well, for you, with the parameters we receive from you. Okay, it's perfect. For you, it's 8 months. We don't have the appointment yet. And then for another person, maybe the parameters comes inside. The parameters come in and we see, this value here, the blood level, it's time to come in. Yeah. And then maybe in 4 months, you have to visit the hospital and do some extra exams. So I think it will become also the possibility to get more personalized treatment based on how you are and not on the average. Yeah. But that's, and I think if we will come there, IT will play an important role to facilitate this, because that's the only way to do it.
Because then it's going to be a combination of AI and I think wearables, bracelets or chips or whatever.
All those things, of course, it's very hip there. And like always, we are here and then it will drop again. But of course, there will be leftovers and we will monitor more. We will do more with those data. The sensors will become also much better and much more
affordable.
Much more portable, and then based on this, you can do some stuff that indeed allows you to be more proactive than reactive. But it's a long way to go, it's not only just you need some technology. That's just a small part of it. You need legislation. You need mindset. You need also proven medical. That it's medical proven that it's better or not, because not in all cases this work, of course. So it takes a long time, time to go. But I think the role of a hospital will change in that way. And maybe it's not been 5 years, and it's in 10 years. Yeah.
But maybe with this Corona thing, they also want to monitor the people to open up everything again. So they want to monitor the people who have the virus. In order to make sure that there is no second outbreak. So also there, that's an opportunity to think and even implement these kind of tools and legislation. Because we know each other since 2005. I mean, I then had a BlackBerry, I recall. I mean, I never expected that the adoption of like a smartphone, that I said I will never going to check my mail on a stupid phone, but now it's so common. So I mean, and it's so adopted so rapidly that I'm very reluctant to do any predictions, because I don't know. And especially, as you know, I'm also in a very fast moving business where I cannot longer predict what is going to happen within 6 months. So it's like driving a car and you can only see like 100 meters ahead.
That's true. And that's always,
it's also cool.
It's cool. And that makes life in general, but IT in special, interesting, because it's you, the only thing that you know for certain is that next year it will be different.
Yeah.
And that's what I like. But I can't predict how different it will be. That's very, very difficult, and it's impossible. And also, I stopped doing this.
Yeah, me too. Now, I mean, linked to that, 25 years, you know, leading 60 people. I mean, how did you learn to do that, leading people? Because, like you're just saying, I mean, a lot of people are reluctant to change, and then suddenly a process, technology, whatever way of working needs to change, you need to adapt. And I can imagine that some people, the trendsetters, and some are, I don't want to change anything. How did you learn that? Because I perceive you as a really human person and not some kind of Excel metrics leader. unless you've changed,
No, I can No, I haven't changed. So no, not Excel guy. But I haven't learned. I mean, yeah, you do this by accident. And that's really just an anecdote. It's all my team leads has to follow a course now, how to lead a team.
Is it?
Yep, they have to. And it's organized by the hospital. And so it's a course of several days that they follow. I haven't followed, never. In my time, it was not there. So I have to learn by myself. Fortunately, and that helps a lot, was growing very slowly.
Yeah.
Started downstairs. Was just a member of the team,
yeah,
doing the same shit as they did at that time. Enjoyed a lot, by the way. But and then gradually, and yeah, of course, you don't start with managing. I agree with you. Leading a team of 60 people from the first day, because that would be really a shock. I think it's very difficult to do it from one day to another if you never had got any experience there. But for me, it was very gradual with a small team. Then that small team became bigger, and then a little bit bigger, and then a little bit bigger, and then it's at the end 60 people. Well, I was also never stressed about it. Just worked. I don't know why. And that's the nice thing, I think. Important is what I find very important is you have to trust people. If you don't trust people, then stop. Then it doesn't work.
Yeah.
I've never controlled people. Never got that, because you have to trust. No, that's really micromanagement. That's the person that thinks I have myself and I clone it 50 times and then I put it there. That doesn't work.
No.
Because you want to do it all by yourself and you know better. What was the most important thing to learn, I think, for me, because that was in the beginning difficult, is delegate. So the trust was there, but you have to delegate also. This is your project, just do it
in your own way,
I always said, you only come back to me if you think you are doing something what I don't agree, but you just think if I don't agree. It's sometimes it's a mistake, sometimes you think Reynolds would find it perfect, but maybe I don't. That doesn't matter. That's the cost of this mechanism, but it works very well. Most of the cases, it's done on maybe not on the perfect identical way that I would have done it, but that is not important. It doesn't matter. Delegation, because in the beginning, it was in the beginning first. The first time it was, of course, I can do it better and faster. And then after a while was, this kind of shit, I don't want to give it to someone. I will do it by myself because it's so shitty task. And that are the several steps. But then, you have to delegate and then trust your people. They do well. And what you say is indeed the team. Yeah, in a team you need a lot of mix of different profiles.
Complementary,
and of course they, because if they were all like me, it will be a disaster. So you need very conservative. Conservative.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean bad. Eh? It's just they are focused on availability, uptime. They want
Liability.
To be sure that they can give this service not only today but also tomorrow. You need this kind of people definitely, because they stop other ones that are very enthusiastic and just say, "Let's do this fast," and then forget that there is also a tomorrow. There is also availability, security, and this kind of thing. So you need different kind of persons in the team, and they have to work together and they have to respect each other.
And is that it's that tension that actually is going to move you forward and at the same time keep your internal customers happy. Because the second group, I can call them the innovators, they like the new shiny things and it's great. But there's also things that you have to manage today, which you rely on availability and security, and it's finding that, I wouldn't say balance, but I also believe that having that tension is actually good. Instead, if it would be all the same people, I mean, it's that dialogue who is going to create solutions and new ideas and things like that. And instead of just people saying, yes, it's the same way. And that's personally my belief.
Yeah, people that just say always yes to you, that's wrong. Eh? That has no added value. You can automate this with a robot. You need people to say, no, you're wrong. Or have you think on this? Or wouldn't we more consider this? You need this dialogue, this discussion. Yeah. That's important. Otherwise,
but that's unique, Reynolds, because you know I visit a lot of companies. This is a cultural thing, and the culture starts always at the top. A part of it. But I have been in companies where when you said no and you wanted to have a dialogue, you were the first that took an initiative that will cut your head off. I mean, that was no. It's top down. You're just going to execute. If I say jump, you say how high. Nothing wrong with that if that's your strategy. But I really believe in order to, won't say grow, but stand the test of time and to keep your best people, it doesn't work. You have to give them trust and give them some projects and let them do their thing in their own way so that they can grow and then that they can, manifest their potential as a human being. And then connected to that higher organism where they are part of, then you're going to, and also it's funny for you also when people are doing their things that you don't have to control them or micromanage them, and they're only going to commit you when they have a problem and a solution and they want to discuss that with you. It's my personal belief.
Yeah. I when they come to me with a problem, I also want that they provide some solutions that they already have to think about it. People that just only come with I have a problem. Yeah, that's perfect, but that's not good enough. I really want that they are thinking about it and provide already some possible solutions, and that's important. Yeah. One remark, Peter, is at some moment, so I find dialogue very important, but at some moment somebody has to decide,
to
and then then you have to go all together in the same direction.
Yeah, that's true.
But before that, you need really a moment. Yeah. I want to have all the ideas, the possibilities, the risks, but then at some moment we have to decide and then we have to go together with it, if you like it or not. That moment also, you some companies or some places I see this never happen. They postpone the decision and then after 3 years and meetings and meetings and meetings, at some moment you have all the information. Often no, not all the information. That's not necessary. Enough information to make the decision.
Yeah, but that's again that finding that harmony. I fully agree. You have like this organizations where they go into a kind of consensus model, which is indeed great, and decisions taking longer. But they're afraid when the people in the top are afraid of taking decisions because they think that they are going to have dislikes. So people that will not, because they will not feel popular because some people, they have another opinion. I mean, that's the part of a leader. You take a decision, you have a dialogue, and at a certain point say, okay, these are all the ideas. I'm going to pick this one. This seems me the best. This is the decision you communicate to the team, and they have to respect that. Because otherwise you have this like think tank meeting itis thing, and for me it's always simple: or you take a decision or the decision will be taken for you.
Yeah, if you go to the consensus model all the time on the hallway, all your walls will be painted light gray.
Yep.
You will never have a red wall or a blue wall. Sure. It will always gray because that's the consensus. So you need all the information, you need all the opinions, and then decide for one of them.
Yep.
And sometimes it's a compromise, of course. Life is always full of compromises. That's not a problem. But at some moment, someone has to decide based on the information.
But for me, it's like, I wouldn't say a war, but choose your battles. Some battles you will win, and some battles you say, well, this is not important to me. It's okay what they decide. Okay. Now, you're 40 years plus. If you would go back.
You are very, very, very gentle to me. plus.
You're the George Clooney of Leuven, eh? But you at least have hair, no?
Yeah, my hairdresser, of course, it was, yeah, that will be take some time before I go to the hairdresser again, I think.
That's the only advantage that I have already. I should have saved it, but that's another thing. If you would go back, Reynold, and you take a DeLorean, and you go back to the Reynold, you're standing full... You're standing in front of you're standing in front of the university, the doors. You're standing in front of the doors of the university. You're 18 years young. So the Reynold of now is going to meet the Reynold of when he's 18 years young. What are the three things that you would advise him?
Nothing. He has to discover it all by himself. I would really find it. No, yes. I think that's just the part of how you are and where you get is by the experiences, by the mistakes, by the choices you made. Of course, I've thought about several times, well, this I could do differently afterwards. But I think it's how you make it. If someone tells you up front, this is the mistake you will make, or this change, you can better do it differently. I think it will not be the same Reynold anymore. And he will make different mistakes that we're not saying there. And I don't think he will be more happy than I was now. So I think I will say nothing.
Mm-hmm.
I will look at him from distance and I will laugh probably see him doing the strange things.
Yeah.
For the rest, I think I don't want to give him advice.
Yeah. But I share the same opinion. I you're just mentioning the word mistakes, but I see them as lessons. There is in every mistake and a fruit of a lesson that you can learn. You can always blame the other and be a victim.
Afterwards, you're always right. And so doesn't you make at that point a decision and you have to make the best of it, live with it, take the opportunities of it. And you never can retrace if I choose this or what then happened.
Matter.
You don't know because it's not just one and zero there.
Yeah.
A lot of things are then coming back and what the impact is on your later life.
Yeah.
So,
And it would be boring in life.
Yes.
Imagine that you're 18, you know, upfront all the lessons and all the things that you have to do.
It's boring. It's just the everyday learning new things. That's interesting.
That makes you
be confronting with new cases. That's interesting, that makes life interesting. Otherwise, it's indeed boring.
And if you look back, what is for you that you want to share? Of course, the biggest lesson that you've learned.
You see, I don't think backwards, so I don't know.
No, I'm going to share one of mine. This is something that I heard from a lot of people here. They said that was my wife and my kids. It is full energy. If I look back to the all the guests that I've been spoken to, they said to me, all the decisions that I took from my intuition, from my gut, those were the right ones. For instance, somebody came and was applying for a job like becoming a partner in my organization. And I felt in my gut little doubt. But in my head, I was like, yeah, we need it. Let's go for it. And afterwards, it didn't work out properly. And I had that experience a couple of times. And for me, that's one of the biggest lessons.
I think for me, take some more risk. I'm not a risk taker. In office more than in private life, strange enough, I'm not a risk taker. I like to do new things.
Yeah, you travel a lot.
I travel a lot, but risky things. Yeah, that depends on each person, of course. But like financial risks, but also risks in. Oh, this is even in countries that I travel. I must feel safe, for example, okay. And that can be very stupid things. So I'm really taking a little bit more risks. Mm-hmm. Maybe that, that would definitely would change my life a little bit, I think, and maybe would have created some more opportunities. But I feel comfy with it. But yeah. I'm not. So, for example, I still work at UC Leuven. Because I like it.
And it changes every year, you just said.
It changes every year. I like it very much. But maybe if I would take a little bit more risk, then maybe I was working somewhere else. And I don't know if that was better or worse. And I feel very good working in UC Leuven still after 25 years because it gives me pleasure every morning to go to the office. But risk is the things I really always take in account in most of my decisions.
No, I understand that. I mean, I think the most important thing is what you just said. If you get up in the morning and you don't strive for Friday evening, I think then you are, in my personal opinion, doing the right things. I mean, if you're doing something that you feel I'm fulfilling my purpose and I can contribute to something and I can have an impact on, for instance, the people in my team, making them better and helping them achieving their mini dreams, I would call them. I mean, I think that's, I'm on the other way around. I'm like 3-4 years working for a company. I build it. And when it's built, I'm tired of it and go to the next one. And this is, I wouldn't say great, but it's also very tiring because sometimes I envy you because I'm like, yeah, I also want that. But there's something in me that fired the same with this thing that I'm now building in. It's the same. Eh? I enjoy it so much, but of course it takes a lot of time and so on. So I think, it's, for me, that's also the conclusion. Just follow the path of what gives you good energy. I mean, I've, and all the time that I've known you, I never had the feeling that you were racing against some kind of burnout. And you also had your challenges, eh?
No. Well, we keep everything. Wood. We take the wood out of houtvast. But until now, no burnout syndromes. But it can come. It can overcome everybody. By the way, I'm very convinced in this. But I still love my work, and it's important. And of course, that's different for everybody. But I really, when I come home, I can switch off. Yeah. Switch off the bottom and just focus on home, on relaxing, on things that you do in your private life, without thinking tomorrow again, different little meeting, budget constraints, all this kind of things. Now I can really make easily the shift between work and private life, and that helps also, of course.
You have been traveling the last years a lot. Well, in the last years, I think the last 5 years, I believe, or even more.
Last 10 years.
What are the countries that you certainly want to visit, which are on your bucket list? The first ones you're going to visit after Corona?
It's difficult because our bucket list is very long. Costa Rica is on my list, but I really. For me, it's not about this country I want to look. I want to go to places where I didn't went before. And that doesn't mean it's on the other side of the globe. It can be. Last big trip was New Zealand. I can recommend it to everybody. But also, I just went 2 years ago for the first time in Greece. I also enjoy it very much. I really want to have contact with the local people, how the persons there live, and that's how the country works, and really like to have the contact with the local people there to see how their life is, and of course how the environment is, the nature. These are really really like to do. So it doesn't matter where. Where it is, I think I want to visit everything if possible. But Costa Rica is one of the
the number one?
Well, South America. Well, Costa Rica is Middle America, but South America also, never been there. So that, but then also the fear. So like
Mexico, Colombia.
Colombia. So this is more like already Argentina, because that looks more safe. But it's this kind of things I always take in account. But there's a lot of opportunities and possibilities. We will see. There's also no hurry. I hate, by the way, lists. I'm allergic to lists. Yeah. So if someone phones me tomorrow and say, "Let's go to that," and I say, "Yes, yeah, why not? Let's go." That I like much more than just having a list.
But that's actually a very big form of taking risks, Reynold. I mean, if somebody would do that to me. Like tonight we're gone. I mean, my wife is like that, so I adapted to that, and now I enjoy it. But in the beginning, I was like, no, I have to get it in my head so I can plan that. So that's for me a big risk taker. I mean, now, by traveling so much, and especially coming into contact with the local culture, I also believe, that's a question, did that challenge the way you look at the world or your belief systems, because you're conditioned by Belgian culture, the media, and so on and so on. By coming in contact with these locals, are there some things that you learned that you say, these people are looking very different at the world or at life, that you said, I learned something from that? For instance, your wife, I remember we're having a dinner with your wife, and their culture is very different. So we are in Belgium, we meet up, we make an appointment for like 2-3 weeks further, and then we meet each other. There, where she's from Spain, it's like, we're going to send a text tonight, come over, and on the spot, we're going to do some. This is not really in our culture.
I think the most thing what you learn is that, that our culture or my culture or the Flemish or the Belgium or whatever culture, it's just a culture like everyone else. Yeah. And it's just nice to see that some of the, what I realize, some of the habits we have, you see also complete on the other side of the world also happen. And also you see complete different things on the other side, or even in Spain, different things. I just like to see the differences, and it opens you, I think, very much. It really gives you always not the reflex of we do it better, or like our way is the way. Yeah, that's really, I was already convinced years before that, but when you travel, then you see, people are also very happy, and I like that. So for example, with Spain, English is from Spain, we adapt also some of the Spanish things now here. We eat at 9 o'clock in the evening dinner every day. It's a stupid thing, but how it is. I was also in the past more planned about meeting friends and this kind of things. Now it's a little bit less. I mean, sometimes, if you meet with Flemish friends, you have to plan it up front because they have an agenda, and you have to find the free moment. But it must not be planned like always. So that's also things I've seen, things I've learned. And most important, especially when you go a little bit to other continents, I think Africa, I think of Myanmar, for example. You see, and that makes you smaller, you see that people can also be very, very happy with much less. And I think a lot of people also, some of the people experience this maybe now also, is in this period. It's not that we enjoying COVID, of course, but you learn to see the small things and to appreciate the small things. Yes, we can go walking outside. Wow. If I now go outside, I see everybody walking, jogging, doing all those things. In the past, I mean, never doing this. It was and you see they're enjoying the small things there, and they appreciate. I hope that stays for a long time for those.
It's the same for me. I mean, as I have been a lot on the road, I mean, now I have to stay at home, and people have adopted this kind of way of meeting as the new normal, which makes it for me very less stressful and like around 5:30 or something, it depends on the day. I mean, I can go for a running with my son or with a bicycle when it's nice weather. And so I don't have to rush to get home to arrange things or to pick him up. So actually I like that.
So it's and yeah, when you travel, you see this, that people can enjoy life on a different way than you do.
Yeah.
And yeah, and if you go to Africa or Asia, a lot of places, and you see, yeah, they have much less than you. I mean, in money, in property, in possibilities,
yeah.
But still they can be very happy. They can also be very unhappy, by the way.
It's
like food,
yeah,
drinks,
yeah, yeah.
The regime can make them very suffering. But that's what you see there is, for example, Madagascar, we had a guide. We always try to choose when we have a guide, depends on the country. We take a very local one. We not by an agency, we go directly. We try to find one, and it was a really lovely guy that involves his whole family to get us around Madagascar. And then, yeah, they have almost nothing. And still was a very interesting guy, and yeah, he seems, yeah, he was in my eyes very happy, although he had a lot of very painful experiences in the family, dad, his illnesses, and this kind of things, but yeah, he was enjoying the small things, and that also we have to learn from time to time.
Great. Last question, although I have lots of questions, I could go on for hours, but we'll do that offline. What is still a very crazy dream for you to do or to be? A crazy one, eh? Not a crazy one. Not, I'm going to go open a house in New Zealand, although that can be a crazy dream.
I really want once to get to the... Ile de Pasque, Paaseiland.
Yeah.
It's in English, but yeah. That's just a question of money. It's not a thing. Oh no! If you want a really crazy idea, well, to present be a spokesman of the government now for the Corona crisis. If you want to say this, I think I can do better. I think, and secondly, I would love to do. I think this kind of things. That's. If you want a crazy idea, that's maybe something I would love to do. And well, in my PowerPoints, it will be nicer, better, clearer. But maybe well, probably the same spelling errors than they had. But that's
at least your machine would work.
Yes. You ask a crazy idea. There it is.
Yeah. Reno, thanks a lot for the conversation. I mean, it's already over 1 hour. I'm very grateful having you as a guest. You thought you were going to say nothing, but on the contrary, I think it's a very valuable episode, and I'm going to launch it earlier So I want to thank you for your time.
It was a pleasure, Peter, and also nice to see you again.
And you enjoyed it?
Yes, of course. I knew I was enjoying it, but I don't know if it was worth for has some value.
Of course,
enjoying talking, that's not ever a problem. Eh?
No, it's. I think the most important, not the most important, one of the things is that you have given us an insight how from somebody working from IT, which is also a part of the team of a hospital. It's dealing with that. What is the impact? How you're doing with that? And I think that's something in the media that they always talk about the doctors and they get the credits and the nurses. But this is also very important. There are also other people who take care of that experience of the patients. And I think that there is not a lot of people talk about that and are not aware of that.
Yeah, and IT is just a small part. Eh? I think on the cleaning cleaning team that has to clean all those rooms, they are really confronting also with all the things. The technical department that has to arrange things. It's the whole hospital, everybody.
Yeah, that's the involved. Thing.
And that's, yeah, of course, you focus only on the ones that are on the front line. And that's good and that's perfect. But there's a lot of people also working.
Yeah, but they cannot do it without you.
Well, maybe it without me, but without the teams.
Yeah, team, the team. Them. You, I mean the teams. And
without me, they can. That's not a problem.
Yeah. Okay. See you soon, Reinhard. And take care. Bye-bye.
Peter, bye.